Just after eight. Good evening.
And some good news for you and some sad news. In the headlines, a crowning honor for Nadine Gordimer, the Nobel Prize for Literature.
Oh, well, of course, I was truly amazed. People don't believe this because other years I've known that I was on the short list. You know, it's happened a number of times. But I was away in America and I didn't know that I was on the short list again. And, you know, I really hadn't thought about it at all. So I was extremely surprised, and of course I was also thrilled, anybody would be. I get asked what I'm going to do with the money all the time. I must say I find it an impertinent question. If somebody wins a lottery or a horse race, or a businessman, this is not a lottery or a horse race, but, and if a businessman suddenly makes a fortune on a deal, nobody would think of asking him. But of course we writers are mountebanks and strolling players, nobody takes it very seriously. So I don't really mind being asked. Some of the money I want to use for development of cultural organizations, principally writers, that I'm particularly interested in. Organizations that I work with, like the Congress of South African Writers. I'm particularly interested there in a small project we have to publish writing in African languages. Think of the Nobel Prize winners who are dead and who are forgotten. There are the, you know, the great ones we don't forget, like William Faulkner, Thomas Mann. One would read him anyway, whether he'd had the Nobel Prize or not. But I think it does keep books in print. And so maybe some of the writers that we would not have had the privilege of reading now, books that are not in print, have been kept in print because they received the award. I was, like many children, imaginative child, always indulging in make-believe, in play, you know, and I think a bit of a show-off. I was very keen on dancing. I wanted to be a dancer and making up little plays and things like this. But then I began to write very young, the age of about 9 or 10, and I published my first adult story when I was 15, which was a big thrill because I sent it off to a journal and they didn't know, and so they just thought it came from an adult. My father had his jeweler's shop here. It's all changed now. It's now a fish and chip shop. It's really unrecognizable for me. My father came from Latvia, from near the seaport of Riga, when he was 13 years old. At that time, there was a lot of Tsarist suppression, and my father couldn't go to high school. Jews were not allowed to have higher education. And his father, who was a shipping clerk, I suppose that gave him the advantage. He was able to get passages for his children, his two sons, to go out to another part of the world, and they both came to South Africa. My father, I mean, at the age of 13, not knowing any English, it must have been really very, very tough, I think. Very tough indeed. He had trained as a watchmaker, but he then branched out and began to sell rings and watches and other things as well. My mother came from England at the age of 6. She came from a Jewish family that was completely assimilated. I think they had been there since William the Conqueror. I knew my maternal grandfather and grandmother. He had come out in around about 1880 to prospect for diamonds, very unsuccessfully, I may say. So that's my family background. This was our house. It's really unrecognizable, except for the gate, exactly as I remember it, 89 on it. Must have been a pretty good piece of wood to last all this time. All the rest has been changed. Unrecognizable. Nothing left.
How was it, your youth? Because, I mean, many people like to talk about your childhood, but...
Well, it wasn't a particularly happy childhood. And I think when I became adolescent, then there was really nothing that I related to in this town. It was very dull. If it hadn't been for the library, I don't know what I would have done, because books meant everything to me.
Was it a very lonely childhood as well?
Well, I had one sister, but it was a pretty lonely childhood. I think so. But of course, that's quite a common beginning for writers. It makes you very introspective.
Yes.
And then you live in books and you live in your imagination. So that...
So it is true, an unhappy childhood is a writer's goldmine.
So they say, yes, as long as it isn't too unhappy. But I think also to dwell on it is bad, you know. You can't live the rest of your life on what the Americans call a crummy childhood. And of course, from the point of view of a writer, you always get a lot out of it. A lot out of that childhood. You draw on it. In my most recent novel, after many years and so many books in between, I created an imaginary town like this one, and for the purposes of one of my characters. And it was amazing that it all came back to me, all the details, the smell of it, the feel of it, since I started to think about it.
You were attending only white schools.
Yes, I went to the convent of Our Lady of Mercy, which is, well, now it's built up, but it was just across the veldt here. I used to walk across the veldt to school. And it was an all-white school, it was a girls' school. Everything was all-white. It's a Catholic school. Yes, Catholic nuns. The Dominican
nuns.
Order. All nuns. Now I think there may be some, yes, there are some lay teachers. But when I was there, it was all nuns.
Do you have good memories about the nuns?
No, I think it's a kind of unnatural atmosphere, you know, to be brought up at school in. Without any men around, it was girls only. Now I believe it's co-ed. And now it is also open to all races, if you can pay. But when I was here, it was whites only and girls only. And I remember once in one free period, there was a dare from the other kids that I should go into this part of the school, which was where the nuns lived then, because we wanted to know what they wore when they went to bed. So I stole in there, fast beating heart, and went into one of their little cells and looked under the pillow and found their nightgown and a sort of little cap that they wore, and then came out again absolutely terrified, but I didn't get caught.
What do you do with religion now, if you're not religious? I mean,
I don't do anything with it. I'm an atheist, I'm a humanist. Religion, you know, doesn't play a part in my life. I respect people who are religious. I've known some wonderful people whose lives are structured from the point of view of religion. But it's not possible for me.
What do you do with your life after death, then? I mean, if you don't believe, it's much easier if you would believe.
Oh, of course. I sometimes feel that when something happens in your life, if you have religion, you've got a means to deal with it. You know, there are certain forms and certain things that you can do that deal with joys and sorrows. If you haven't a religion, you're on your own. You simply deal with it as it comes, but it's not something that really worries me. When I was in my early 30s, I went through a time when I felt some lack of the religious structure in my life, and I read people like Simone Weil and others. But, you know, faith is a leap. There's no rational way toward faith, and it was not possible for me.
Every day I sing the blues. I might be cabbage looking, baby. Yes, but I'm not as green as all that, baby. Please don't squeeze me. Every day, every day I sing the blues. I might be cabbage looking, baby, but I'm not as green as all that. But the good Lord made me so, baby. Please don't squeeze me. Every day. Every day I say goodbye, baby, please. You know, I have a mother-in-law, you know. My mother-in-law is a very ugly woman, you know. She has got very long tooth, you know. Her legs are as thin as a broomstick. I could hardly hide myself behind my mother-in-law's legs. But there's one thing I'm proud of my mother-in-law, because she gave me a daughter to get married with. Today I'm a father of a lot of children through that ugly mother-in-law of mine. That's why I say, never you judge a book by its cover. You must always try and read the contents inside. After reading the contents, and then you'll be buying the right book. Mother-in-law. Some stupid people are blaming you for being so ugly, forgetting that the good Lord made you so.
I think the first time I'd ever been into a black ghetto, a black township, was during my days as an amateur actress. That was one of the few things I enjoyed here as I grew up. It was during the war. I belonged to an amateur acting group. I loved it. And we used to go, there were big camps here. It was a huge RAF camp not far from here. So we used to go there and perform for the troops. But we also once went with the most unsuitable play I could ever think of, Oscar Wilde's Importance of Being Earnest. We went into the black township, Painville, and gave a performance here. It was the first time in my life I'd ever been in a black township. I was 21. My mother was a progressive-minded person for her time and the place where she lived. She was one of a group of white women who started a creche for black children in the township. So you can see the paradox there. But the black woman who worked with her, supported her, helped her bring up the children, she never shared a cup of tea with her. Strange.
When did you find out that racism is evil?
Oh, I think it started here. It started, if we drive by, I'll show you where the mine concession stores were. The storekeepers used to buy a concession to run a store on a mine. And this was near the mine compound, the barracks where the mine workers worked. And I would pass there on my way to school. And I saw these mine workers who were so exotic to me. At that time, many of them still wore tribal dress. You would see the Shangans who came from Mozambique with clay locks in their hair, different kind of dreadlocks from the ones you see now. And they would still be wearing their blankets. And they seemed to me so exotic. It occurred to me later on that I was the exotic one, the white. They were at home. It was their continent. But I saw the way that they were shouted at by the white storekeepers. Their money was good enough, but they were treated, one can't say like dogs, because most dogs are much better treated than that, but really very, very harshly and disparagingly, despisingly treated. These were the beginnings, the inkling. People think because English is my mother tongue and I write in English that when I'm in England, I've come home. It's not home to me. It's a foreign country. America's a foreign country. I resent the fact that when I was a child, at school and at home, nobody told me that this was really part of my heritage and my culture since I was born here. I've often given the example, but I repeat it because it's a good one, I think, that in this mining town where I was born and brought up, we lived near a mine compound where thousands of mine workers, black mine workers, were kept in this so-called hostel, more like a barracks. And on Sunday mornings, always wake up and hear not European church bells, as you might in Europe at that time, but drumming and singing and music. And what, if one said, you know, what is this? Then you were told, oh, it's the mine boys kicking up a row. Nobody told me that this was the culture of the indigenous culture of South Africa. But indeed, they were, this was their music, their dance. Well, Proust has had, you know, that's a guiding spirit up there on my wall. I started reading Proust in my teens, about 14, 15, during the war, in English. And it was an absolute revelation to me. I mean, that enormous book is still a very great book, and I, through my life, I have gone back and reread it from time to time. My books have been many, have covered many areas of human life, been very different. Because they have taken place in a highly charged political atmosphere, of course, there's always been a people, my characters have been influenced by politics. But, for instance, two of my novels, separated by about 10 years, that is Burger's Daughter, which is regarded as my most political book because it's about a communist family in South Africa. That's a quick way of talking about it. It's about much more. It's also about the relationship between the father and daughter. What I've observed as something very interesting in terms of the so-called generation gap, that the generation gap in highly politicized families, rather as in very religious families, where there's a faith that overrides the normal tensions in the family, instead of the young people revolting against the faith of the parents, becoming unbelievers, whether politically or religiously, they follow in the footsteps, they take on the faith. This has been quite a phenomenon in South Africa, where generation after generation in the same families, people have continued in the struggle for freedom, have gone to prison, have sacrificed their personal lives. Then I looked at it in my most recent novel, My Son's Story. Well, there are the tensions between the father and son, principally, though the other members of the family as well. There's also the question of the tensions of sexual emotions, sexuality. I think that these are, to me, what I've observed to be the driving forces in life. Sex and politics are the two most interesting aspects of human life.
So, in fact, power?
They are different forms of power, I suppose, but there comes into it also the wish to live well, the wish to be loved.
Why are relationships in your books most of the time very difficult? I mean, it doesn't seem to work out very easy between male and female.
I don't think that human relationships are easy. I think they're very, very difficult. And I think people never know each other, really. Lovers don't really know each other, and husbands and wives don't, children and parents. We always think we know. And then you find out that there were aspects of that person's life that others knew that you didn't. I think this is very marked in one's relationship with one's parents, because you don't know really about your parents' private life. When you begin to become mature yourself and have the same kind of emotions, you understand your parents in a way that you didn't. You judged them too quickly when you were a child or adolescent.
11th July 1979, Burger's Daughter is banned under the Publications Act of 1974. A World of Strangers and the Late Bourgeois World were banned for 12 and 10 years.
When my books were banned, it was very distressing at the time. It's a very strange feeling. I've sometimes described it as you feel ghost-like, you know, in your own country. I was fortunate enough to be writing in a world language, in English, and so I knew that, in other words, my books were not dead. Somebody was reading them somewhere, but you want to be read in your own country by your own people. The only book that I knew would be banned was Berger's Daughter, because not only did it show a communist as a good man and a human being, something unthinkable at the time, yeah, and in
but
many other
parts.
Why
did you do it then, if I may interrupt you? I mean, was there any sympathy for this communism at that time?
It wasn't a matter of sympathy for communism. It was the fact that I knew many people who were like my imaginary family. I not only admired them because I saw they were doing what other white people were not doing, that they were taking leadership from blacks and that they were personally sacrificing in the way that other whites were not. Other whites were talking, they were doing. And that they put their personal lives second, which to me is a fascinating phenomenon. And that was my approach to the book. I was not making a point about any particular political faith. But I knew, because in that book I quoted from all sorts of little pamphlets and things that were around at the time that came out not just from the communists, but from everybody in the different branches of the liberation movement. Everything was banned at the time that I wrote that book. And so I knew when I quoted from these pamphlets that the book would be banned, because these were banned pronouncements that I was quoting. But the other books, the first one that was banned was my second novel called A World of Strangers. And that was a big surprise when it was banned, because at that time the reason why books were banned was because there would be a love affair between a black and a white. There was no love affair in that book. So that was a bit of a surprise. When it comes to banning books, in the last few years that has stopped. And now, really, not only fiction, but even very controversial non-fiction books dealing, for instance, with the conditions under which people are held in detention, these have been published. A recent book has just come out last week about the Sharpeville 6, a treason case. Not a treason case, I forget quite what the formulation was, but anyway, it was something under the umbrella of overthrowing the state. That book has been published. I don't think that exile is a cowardice. I mean, there were many people I've known well. If they hadn't gone into exile, they probably would have spent their lives in prison. And there are very few people who are heroic enough to face that. But many of my friends had spent long periods in prison, and their lives were in danger when they were out of prison. And it was impossible for them to carry on any of their political work here. So they quite rightly went into exile, a great sacrifice, because all people who loved their country and didn't want to go. And those who went abroad and continued to work for liberation here, many simply gave up their lives, their private lives for this. One can only have tremendous admiration for the sacrifice. I was fortunate in a way, because the only exile that I would have really considered would have been going to live somewhere else in Africa. I had many friends, for instance, in Zambia, you know, when independence came there, and had been up and down there many times. And when things were so much in the doldrums here that nothing seemed to be moving, I vaguely thought, you know, perhaps one should go and live in a neighboring country. But going back and forth in Africa, I realized that there I was just another white face. I was like anybody coming on a contract, you know, to do a job there and going back to their home in Europe. Whereas the only place that I was recognized as belonging was right here in South Africa. And that even people who during the 70s were anti-white never really denied the fact that you know, whites were here to stay. I think art is a political weapon, and I think we have used it in this country. We have been, as artists and writers, we have been of use, I think in a very special way, in expressing what people, other people couldn't express, were too frustrated to express. So I think there we have had a role to play. In other words, one has helped to keep the spirit up of people, that they knew that these things could come out.
Can I say there were periods in your life that there was a kind of despair that it never would happen?
Yes, I think that there were periods in the 70s when all freedom of speech was banned, freedom of assembly, there were no meetings, when everything seemed to be crushed except for the activity that was going on underground, which by the very nature of the way people were oppressed was violent. It was a very discouraging time. But once in the 80s it began to pick up. From 1980, when the when black trade unions were recognized, things began to move.
But you also think, well, it is also a little bit the result of what I did myself?
Oh, no. I wouldn't flatter myself. I think my contribution is not something that one can measure. It's very small compared with the main work was done by blacks. They're the ones who really sacrificed. There were a few exceptions. There were some extraordinary white people, like Brom Fisher, Beyers Naudé, and a number of others whose names would not be familiar in the outside world. Well, I mean, the people who've come out of prison, many, many years in prison, and who, as soon as they're out, they take up the political activity again, taking the same risks as they did before. I call that heroic.
My hero.
Oh, you should have been. Wonderful, wonderful. Love from
yourself. Who is the greatest hero? Is it still Nelson Mandela?
Well, Nelson certainly is a hero, but as I say, you know, there are others, many of them nameless. Of course, Nelson's extraordinary 27 years in prison. But then Tambo was also, Oliver Tambo was in prison for all that time, and so were a number of others. Brom Fisher lived out the major part of his life in prison. And when he died, his family, his daughters and son, were not even allowed to have his ashes in case these became a subject of martyrdom. I don't think you can be much harsher than that to people's feelings, that you won't even give back the ashes of somebody's own father.
Dear friends, we are here tonight to celebrate a quite uncommon event, the nomination of a South African Commandeur des Arts et Lettres. You have always said no to the apartheid system. In those thrilling times of negotiations, it seems to me very important not to bury apartheid too quickly. Your works seems to fit in the motto, forgive, but don't forget.
Optimistic about this country in the long run. I think that one couldn't expect there not to be many problems and many troubles and many hitches. One couldn't expect this all to come about entirely peaceably after 350 years. But I think that there's so much will to make things work out here. And there's also there has been such amazing tolerance on the part of blacks when you think of what has been done to them over the years, that the willingness of a very large proportion of them to cooperate with whites, to accept the fact that there are people here who are white Africans who belong here, I think is remarkable. I don't know whether it's happened anywhere else on this continent. Obviously, if we're going to have one man, one vote, which we are going to have, then you're going to have a black majority government. But I'm confident that there will be whites in certain positions in that government, and there'll be Indians in certain positions in that government.
So and you're not afraid that the whites will become second-class citizens?
If we have a Bill of Rights, and all rights, individual rights are respected, people must forget about what color they are. For me, the mistake is that there are some white groups here who want special minority rights as whites. This is a different thing from wanting freedom of religion as a Muslim, a Christian, a Jew, an animist, or whatever you are. That's a different kind of freedom. But to want special protection because you are one color or another, this is a way of perpetuating what we've had all along and what we have wanted to get rid of. That people, I think whites have made a great mistake, as they did when Rhodesia became Zimbabwe, that you had to have a white group with minority rights protected. I think you only need that if you don't have the rights of the individual protected. In the past few years, something like 6,000 blacks have been killed. Not just black-on-black violence, but killed by the police, shot. And I don't know how many have been killed since the Sharpeville massacre in 1960. A handful of white people have been killed. You know, this is the answer. I can't see why whites should be so afraid. Because it is quite a miracle, considering what has happened here, that whites, so few, have been killed. And they have usually been killed because they have stumbled into a situation where feelings were running very, very high. Or they've simply been caught in crossfire, so to speak. Fear is a terrible thing. We're all afraid of the gangsterism that always arises in times of change like this. Where you get, you know, the criminal elements taking advantage of, first of all, of unrest, of pretending to be part of a liberation movement. I mean, you get people robbing banks and saying, you know, we're the ANC. It's nothing to do with the ANC. That, I think, the aspect, the fear, and that fear is of blacks and whites, the criminal element, and also because of the rising unemployment. People can't get work. They're poor. You create a new criminal class, people who probably wouldn't have been criminals before. And we all, black and white, are afraid of those people. I suppose the lack of security in our house, maybe it's stupid, because you're protecting yourself against criminals, not against black people as such. Of course, for many people, the two are synonymous. And there are a lot of white criminals in this town as well. But there's a lot of petty theft and not so petty theft and breaking in, because there's so many people who are unemployed. There's so many people who feel absolutely hopeless, who have nowhere to live and nothing to eat. So I suppose, you know, it's easy then to become a criminal. I think it was Bertolt Brecht who said, first feed the face and then talk right and wrong.
Volgens die politie is die aanval van Harry Mansfield herstel gedoen nadat een Zulu sprekende man vroeger vanochtend bij die Mansfield statie aangevallen is. Passagierstrein 9023 van een vereniging naar Johannesburg heeft kort voor 6 uur bij die
statie. Well, I have ideas about what has led up to it. And I think that the outside world sees it very simply as black on black violence, because that's what you see. But this is politically inspired violence. And it's a very complicated question, but I think the main answer, simplified answer, but nevertheless a valid one, is that it was started by the disaffection and disappointment of Chief Kachibutelezi and his private army, the Inkatha, which was trained and supported by the, financed by the South African government, because they were using Buthelezi for years as their very personable, sophisticated and articulate black spokesperson against sanctions. He naturally thought that when the time came for talks between black and white at a serious level to bring about a new dispensation in South Africa, he would be the man we talked to. And then when Nelson Mandela was let out and the liberation movements were unbanned, he found that this was not so. So what option did he have? He could have taken it gracefully, but he did not. He had not fought for liberation the way Mandela had. Mandela was 27 years in prison while Buthelezi was safely in Ulundi. I think that Buthelezi then saw that he had the power to cause trouble, to stir up feelings, to bring a resurgence of old, buried, forgotten tribal feelings through his Inkatha cadres, and therefore delay talks between Mandela, the other liberation movements, and the South African government. And I think he has done this from his point of view successfully, because he seems to have been unable to stop the violence, kept blaming it on the African National Congress. And now he has really held a panga at the head of the ANC and of the government. And he is obviously going to be at the negotiating table on a more or less equal level with Mandela. From these hostels, these unisex hostels, where thousands of men, literally thousands, live together in totally unnatural circumstances. They're just units of labor. They go to work, they come back. They live in this confined kind of life. No women, very little recreation. They don't belong to the town, really. This means that every little argument that comes about is it's like a match that has been lit.
If you go to these hostels and you compare it to the way you're living here, does it bother you?
Well, of course it bothers me. Doesn't it bother you when you go to the slums in the city where you live? But at least in the slums in the city where you live, it's not a matter of color. It's a matter of class and economic difference. But, you know, it can bother you on very many different levels, not just the hostels, but also the shacks where people live, the squatter camps.
But are you thinking about it quite often?
Very often, because I go to these places. Most white people don't go. If you don't go, you don't have to be bothered. You don't think about it. This is Alexandra Township. It's the oldest black ghetto serving Johannesburg. the very name Alexandra Township, it's named for the for Queen Alexandra, the wife of Edward VII, and it started about 1910 or 1912. It had some quite solid housing at the beginning, but now there are so very many people here over many years. It's deteriorated into a terrible slum. You can see people are living in the most appalling conditions. And in some places where blacks, and I'm talking about blacks in the broad sense, people who also have mixed blood, people who are of Indian origin, where they lived in fairly decent housing, very near the town, they were moved during the years of Grand Apartheid. They were moved out, and sub-economic housing was put up for whites who couldn't afford to build for themselves. But it's never been done for blacks. We've spent millions in this country for decades now on arms, on our army. If that money were to be deflected into providing decent living conditions for people, we would at least make a start. See, over there with those nice houses, that's a start, but it's a class division again. Those are middle class people. What about the poor who cannot afford to raise the down payment to get a bond to build a house? All the people who are standing around me now, they couldn't in their wildest dreams. So they have to go on renting. Many of these shacks, the rent is very high. You wouldn't think so. People are exploited.
So in fact, there's another kind of apartheid.
Well, that's a class difference, economic difference, yes. For me, the ANC's ideals and the ANC's political philosophy is one that I feel like I belong to.
But ANC also stands for violence.
Well, it was necessary during ANC does not stand for violence now. ANC is now unavoidably provoked into violence in the sense of people defending themselves. But violence during the time that we had, the ANC was underground, during the time that Mkhonto Wesizwe, the armed wing of the ANC, was fighting. This was absolutely necessary. For many, many years, peaceful protest, civil disobedience, it had all been tried without moving the South African government and without getting any support from the world outside, from the Western world certainly. There was support from the Eastern world, from the East, but not from the West. If somebody comes and burns down your house and kills a member of your family, I think that it's very likely that you are going to want to take revenge. This is only human. So we've got a cycle of violence. We've also, through the long years of state violence, got used to thinking that the only way you can solve problems is through violence.
You're always called the white conscience of your country.
Oh, well, I don't like these grandiose generalizations, you know. I wouldn't call myself that. I think we have to take the responsibility for all that whites have done. And the way to take that responsibility is not to beat your breast and say, mea culpa, how terrible, but to oppose this, the governments that we've had, to oppose racism, to oppose the color bar. And that I've done to the best of my ability all my life. Ever since I began to see the natives all around, not as furniture, trees, or the casual landmarks of a road through which my life was passing, but as faces, the faces of old men, of girls, of children. Ever since they'd stepped up all around me, as they do, silently, at some point in the life of every white person who lives in South Africa, something had been working in me. The slow, corrosive guilt, a guilt personal and inherited, amorphous as the air, and particular as the tone of your own voice, which, admitted or denied, is in all white South Africans.
Bam, Rigwamben, how about my jaws? What are our potences?